evening, New Beginning Church and our online family and friends. Thank you for joining us on this evening for Bible study. We pray that you will click that share button and start a watch party with your family and friends. I have an announcement or reminder that on Sunday we will celebrate 16 years that Pastor Davis was elected pastor of the New Beginning Church. And we pray that you will join us for our online service at 10:45. It would be a blessing to have the most views watched online on Sunday to show your appreciation for Pastor Davis. Dr. Dolores Sattler sent me some encouraging words today, and I want to share them with you. She quoted Vivian Green, and Vivian Green says, "Life is not about waiting for the storm to pass. It's about learning to dance in the rain." And Dr. Sattler, she says that we can't just wait for bad things in life to go away. We just have to keep God in front, take the challenges head on, and enjoy the journey. Now, in the midst of COVID-19, I know you're wondering, how can I enjoy this journey when this journey has taken some of my loved ones and when I'm battling COVID-19 as well? Well, the answer is to keep God in front. Pray to God to give you strength, and I promise you, God will do it. God will cause you to go through whatever you're going through. And when you get on the other side, you'll look back and wonder, how did I make it over? I am a living witness that God will do it. Our scripture comes from Psalm 149, 3 through 5. It says, "Praise his name with dancing, accompanied with tambourine and harp. For the Lord delights in his people. He crowns the humble with victory. Let the faithful rejoice that he honors them. Let them sing for joy as they lie on their beds." It says, as you lie on your beds, sing for joy. So we have to tell our soul to take courage and come on, soul, we can do this. And you can do it. Our song tonight is, "The storm is passing over. Take courage, my soul. Let us journey on." Though the night is dark and I am far from home, thanks be to God, the morning light appears and the storm is passing over. My soul, and let us journey on. Though the night is dark and I am far from home, thanks be to God, the morning light appears. The storm
storm.
storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. Hallelujah. Take courage, my soul, and let us journey on. Though the night is dark,
yes, it is,
and I am far from home. Thanks be to God, the morning light appears. The storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. Hallelujah.
Father God, we thank you now. Lord, we bless you, we magnify you, we lift you, Father God. We thank you, Lord, for who you are, for what you do, for the way you've done things. Lord, we bless your name. We thank you, Father, for just being good and being God. We praise you, we honor you, we magnify you, Father God. We make you big before men. And Lord, we lift you in such a way, Father God, that you promise that you would draw all men unto yourself. Lord, we ask you to bless us now as we come before you, Father God. Bless your word to be real to us. Bless your word, Father God, to fall on good soil, that your word, Father God, would be what men need on this given day. We ask you to bless us now, bless all our listeners, bless every member, bless every visitor. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and thank God. Hallelujah. Yes, the storm is passing over. Yes, that storm. There's a storm, but it is passing over.
The storm is passing over.
Yes, it is.
The storm is passing over.
That storm.
The storm is passing over. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. The storm is passing over. The good thing about going through a storm, you get a chance to go through the storm.
Amen.
You don't have to stay in the storm. The storm is passing over. We serve the awesome and the amazing God, and he's blessed us again to dive into his word. Let me call your attention again to Colossians chapter 1. We'll be looking again at verses 26 through 29. Colossians in the New Testament, the book is Colossians, the chapter is 1. We're looking at verses 26 through 29 is where we are tonight. I know we closed out with verse 26 on last week, but in order for the pericope to flow really well, we have to look at verse 26 one more time. And if the Lord says the same, we will close out chapter 1 of Colossians tonight. Hallelujah. We will close out chapter 1 of Colossians on tonight. It's been a good study in chapter 1. And so then next week we'll pick up in chapter 2 of Colossians. So we're at Colossians chapter 1, verses 26 through 29. Let me read again verse 26. God is making himself clear. The Apostle Paul is writing, and he mentioned the word mystery. And we've heard it said several times before that there's a mystery in the Word of God. There's a mystery in Jesus the Christ, but then he tells us that this mystery has been revealed. Yes. This mystery has been uncovered. This mystery has been uncovered to the saints of God. Let's look at verse number, it starts in the middle of the sentence. So let's back up, look again. It starts all the way back up to verse number 24. He talks about the rejoicing and suffering in the affliction of Jesus Christ for the sake of the body. The body of Christ is what we are sacrificing for. We are sacrificing for those who are born again believers in the Lord Jesus Christ. So he goes further to say that the house of God, the ministry of God, the church of God, the people of God is the body of Christ, of which I became a minister. He talks about the fact that he became a minister to the stewardship or the dispensation, the stewardship from God, which was given to me for you. God has given us ministers. God has given us ministers for us, for our good. Paul writes this text to the church at Colossae. He says to them that I've been called, I have become a minister for your sake. He says, I have been called to be a minister according to the stewardship from God. I have this ministry in me as a minister of God. I'm here for the stewardship. In other words, God has given us gifts, and those gifts that he has given us, we ought to use it to glorify him. We ought to use our gifts to glorify God. Mm-hmm. Some have been given the ministry of ministering. Mm-hmm. And if you've been called to be a minister, you ought to be ministering even if you're not in the church building.
All right.
There is no excuse for any minister to not be ministering in such a time as this. Mm-hmm. We ought to be ministering. Every choir member, if you're not singing in the choir, you ought to be ministering. Every usher, every first impressions member ought to be ministering. You ought to be finding somebody to minister to. You ought to ask God, God, send somebody my way that I can minister to them. I won't forget, I went home for the holiday and went to Walmart in Mississippi, in Indianola, Mississippi, and I ran into one of my classmates that I hadn't seen in probably 30 to almost 40 years since graduation. And you know, we're coming up on our 40th year of graduation. Hallelujah to the Lamb. That ought to tell you something. That means that I'll be 58 because I was 18 when I graduated. Okay, so I ran into one of my classmates that I hadn't seen in about 30 years, and he talked to me, and we had small talk, asked how everybody was doing, how the family was, and right before I walk away, he said to me, I just need to ask you one question. I said, yes, sir. He said, have you received Jesus Christ as your personal Savior? Now, he's a truck driver now, but he finds himself asking one question to everybody he meets, and that question is, have you received Jesus Christ? Now, I wish I could have played the game with him. I wish I could have said, well, are you interested in leading me to Christ? Just to see if he was able to lead me to Christ. But I said yes to him. And I thought about the fact that he was about ministry, even though he's a truck driver. He's about sharing the word of God. He's about dispensing the word. He's serious about leading men, women, boys, and girls to Jesus Christ. So we ought to use this stewardship from God well. If you've given, and I mentioned this before, if you've been given the talent of cooking tea cakes, you ought to cook tea cakes for those who are in need, and you ought to minister the word of God. Amen. You ought to minister by way of the word of God. I'm a part of a ministry called Out of the Ashes. And Sister Elaine Joseph, she talks about the fact that we have to minister to the homeless. And see, she says one Christmas she gave us a wrap of a gift. And then on the outside of the gift, it had a $5, $3, whatever she had chosen to put in there that particular season. And she had it wrapped with $3 or $4 or $5. And she said, when you stop at the red light and there's a homeless person there, don't be concerned about what they're going to do with these few dollars, because it's only a few dollars. She said to them, give them this food, give them this bottle of water, but make sure you give them the money also. That was her way of creating ministry within us in such a way that we have an opportunity to evangelize, because there was a track in there also. There was a bottle of water in there. There was some tea cakes in there. So everybody have an opportunity to minister regardless of what your gift is. Amen. God deliver me from preachers that have to be in the pulpit in order to minister. Because if you are an associate minister, you don't get the opportunity to stand every Sunday, but that ought not be your excuse why you're not ministering.
That's right.
You don't get the opportunity to stand behind the sacred desk of authority every Sunday. You don't get the opportunity to minister to people every Sunday from the pulpit. But that should not stop you from ministering.
Amen.
if you are a truck driver, if you are a backhoe digger, if you are a heavy equipment operator, if you are a mechanic, if you are an engineer, you ought to minister. Mm-hmm. There ought to be some theology of work wound up in you. There ought to be some work round up in you. As you work, you ought to be able to give off theology. And your theology ought to be just what we're going to talk about tonight, Jesus Christ himself. He talks about the stewardship of God, which was of God. Then he comes to verse number 26, is where we are tonight. The mystery which has been hidden from ages and from generations. He says this ministry has been hidden down through the years from one age to the other. This word ages here refers to from one year to the other. It refers to a season. And this mystery has been hidden from one season to the other. This mystery has been hidden from one generation to the other. Big mama's generation, grandmama's generation, big papa generation. This mystery has been hidden. But look at what he said. And see, people will always tell you God works in mysterious ways. Yes, he works in mysterious ways. But it's only mysterious to those who don't know God. Because we ought to get to know the ways of God. We are to walk with God, fellowship with him in such a way until we get to know him. And we get to know him very well. And we can tell somebody when they say this is what God said, we can tell them that's not God's ways. God does not do it that way. I heard a lady up talking one day on the radio, and I guess she called it preaching, but I call it talking and babbling. But she was up talking on the radio one day, and she made a statement, and you understand why I call it babbling. She made a statement that God will tell you something to do that's not in his word. She said that God will tell you to do something that's not in his word. Let me just share with you. Whenever you start doing things that's not in God's word, it is clear that God didn't tell you to do it. Because God does not operate in a way where he contradicts himself. God will never, ever, ever contradict his word. When you look at God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, neither of the three contradict the other. They are never in competition. They never overstep each other's boundaries. You see, Jesus says, I have to leave here. And when I leave, then the Holy Spirit will come. The Holy Spirit will make himself known. But when the Holy Spirit comes, he will say what I've said. He will show you what I've said. He will carry out what I have predicted. They will always be in concert. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit will always be in concert with one another. They will always be in unison with one another because they are one God. Amen. You have God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. They are one. So he says, this mystery, the mystery which has been hidden from one generation to the other, from one age to the other, from ages and from generations, but now has been revealed to the saints. Mm-hmm. This mystery that has been hidden from one generation to the other, it has been revealed to the saints. Yes. This word mystery, and I told you last week, this word mystery is that which is secret, that which is of a closed mouth. That which is frightening, because some people think that God is a mysterious person and God is so mystical until you can't understand nor explain what God is doing. It is so frightening to people until they cannot know God is at work around them. Yes, God works in mysterious ways, but the text declares that it has been revealed. This mystery and these mysterious ways have been revealed, and it's been revealed to a certain group of people. It's been revealed to the saints of God. The mystery has been revealed. This mystery has been revealed. Look at what it says. It's been revealed to the saints of God. It's been revealed to his saints, yes. To God's saints. It's been revealed. This word saints means the sacred ones. Word saints means the holy ones. This word saints means the blameless ones and the pure ones. If you want a revelation from God, if you want to really see the mystery of God, and we'll explain further what the mystery really is or who the mystery really is, when you want to hear from God, you need to have your life pure. Right. It says blameless. It says sacred. I'm not saying that you will ever be perfect as we know man to be perfect. But we will be perfect, and we will also address that in later verses. If you will be perfect in such a way until you mature in Christ. So he says in verse number 26 that the mystery which has been hidden from ages and from generations, but now has been revealed to his saints. To whose saints? To God's saints. Yes. So the mystery has been revealed. Let's see what he says, Father. To them God willed to make known. To them God will to make known. To the saints. God doesn't want you to be in the dark. He doesn't want you to walk around and talk about it's such a great mystery. He says it's been revealed to the saints. He willed it so. He willed it to make known. What are the riches of the glory? God wants to make known the riches. This word riches means the abundance. God wants to make known the riches. The word riches means valuable. The word riches means wealth. So God wants to make known to his saints the great wealth, the great valuable, the great abundance. God wants to make known what is the riches of his glory. The riches of the glory. The word glory is dignity, honor. The word glory is praise and worship. So here it is. God had given a mystery that was mysterious from one age to the other, from one generation to the other, but he revealed it, Paul says in Colossians chapter 1, verses 26 and 27, he says he revealed it to his saints, to the saints of God. And then verse 27 picks it up and says he willed it so. God willed it so to make known the riches of his glory. To make known the abundance. Let me tell you, God has great abundance for us. Amen. God has great wealth for us. And I'm not talking about just buying what you want to buy, doing what you want to do. God has intangible wealth for us that we can't see right now. God has things for us that we can't even imagine right now. These riches, these wealths, these valuables, he has revealed it unto us, and to them God willed it to be made known. What are the riches of glory? What are the riches of dignity? God is the only one who can give us dignity. People think their title gives them dignity. They think their degrees give them dignity. They think the money they make give them dignity. They think the 401k, 403b, they think their retirement plan would give them dignity. Let me just tell you, you can't depend on any of those things, especially right now.
Yes, sir.
God has a way of getting our attention, and today he has our attention. Yeah. From the beginning of the year, God has gotten our attention like never before. We hear today that even the president of these great United States of America knew that this virus was serious, but he held it from us and said it would go out like a miracle. There's that word miracle again. The president declared that it would affect 15 people and like a miracle, it would be gone overnight. And he made these statements when he knew that it wasn't true. You need to vote. So he says here in verse number 27, to them God willed to make known what are the riches of glory. To whom? To those who are saints. Who did? God did. He wanted to make known the great riches, the great abundance, the great wealth that we have in Jesus Christ. The riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles. Why does he talk about the Gentiles here? Well, because the Gentiles were considered heathens. The Gentiles were considered foreigners. The Gentiles were those who were non-Jewish, and they were considered pagans. They didn't have this Judaism experience. They did not believe and walked in this Judaism religion. And so they were considered heathens, foreigners, non-Jewish blood. They were considered pagans. Even when they had a drop of blood in them, even when they had blood in them, they were not considered full-blooded Jews because they had a drop of blood in them that was not Jewish. Therefore, they did not follow the customs of Judaism, and therefore they were considered pagans and heathens. Because, you know, just like our society today, one particular race or one particular nationality contend that they are higher than other nationalities. Based on their race, creed, color, or national origin, they come to the conclusion that you're down here and I'm up here. That's how it was in that day. Men have always, since day one, men have always considered themselves bigger and better than somebody else. Even if you're of the same race, if your skin is lighter, you consider yourself better than somebody else. James Brown tried to get us right when he came out with the song, Said Loud, I'm Black and I'm Proud, trying to let us know that your skin color does not exclude you from being somebody special.
That's right.
You know, I was confused at one time when I would read a document, it says, we do not discriminate based on race or color. I said, well, isn't race color? Until I got educated, a lady was standing and she was getting a presentation and she wanted us to know the difference between race and color. She says, race, black is white and Asian, those are races. But when you are black and you are a darker shade, then you are a different color than someone who's lighter shade. And for years and years, we've always thought that the light was right and the dark was bad. Jesus set us free. He set us free over 2,000 years ago. Jesus has set us free. We all are on the same level. We're all on the same plane. As you have seen, our church is built in the shape of a cross. And when you go through the front door, everybody goes through the foot of the cross. The idea here upon the building, upon the architectural structure, the idea is we all are the same at the foot of the cross.
Right.
When we go to worship, we are going to be filled by the Spirit of God. We're going to be filled by the Word. And as we enter by way of the cross, at the foot of the cross, we all are the same. And let me share with you, in Jesus' view, we all are the same, regardless of our color, our nationality, regardless of what area of town we were born in, regardless if we were born in wealth or welfare, we all are the same at the foot of the cross.
Amen.
We all need Jesus. We need a Savior. We all were born messed up. And it doesn't matter how long you've been in church, you were born messed up. You were born with a sin nature. You need Jesus. And you need Jesus alone. Jesus died once and for all for both the Jew and the Greek. Jesus set it free. And he set us free. He removed this stigma. That's why young people should not have low such self-esteem, because Jesus has put us all on the same level. We are all the same at the foot of the cross. Get it in your heart, get it in your mind that you're no better than I am and I'm no better than you are, because we all need Jesus. We all need a Savior. This mystery is even among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you. I'm in Colossians chapter 1, verse number 20, 27, 28, 29 is where I'm headed. So he says that this mystery, in verse number 27, this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. He says this mystery is Christ. This word Christ is the anointed one. This word Christ is the Messiah. This word Christ is the one who delivers us. It is the phrase, it is the title of Jesus himself. He is the hope of glory. Who is? Jesus. He's our hope. Amen. Our hope. He's our expectation. Our hope. He is our confidence. Our hope. He is our anticipation. Our hope. He is our faith. If we're going to have faith in anything, we need faith in Jesus Christ. And Jesus alone is the one that strengthens our faith by way of his word. So we need the expectation, our expectation, our anticipation, our confidence, our faith lies in Jesus Christ. He is the mystery. He is the Messiah. He is the anointed one. He is our hope. He's our hope of glory. The word glory again means our dignity, our honor, our praise, and our worship. We ought to be dignified just to know Jesus. We are dignified. The only way we are dignified is through Jesus. People think that they are dignified by what they have, where they've been, who they're associated with. But let me just share with you, you're only dignified through Jesus. This hope of glory, this hope, this anticipation of dignity. And therefore, we ought to worship him. We ought not worship anything or anybody but him. Amen. These days, many people are taking the knee. Many people are taking the knee for social justice. And we ought to stand up. We ought to protest. But we ought to vote. They're taking knees for justice. But let me just share with you. If you protest and you don't vote, Dr. Al Sharpton says, when you protest and you don't vote, you're just talking loud and saying nothing. Mm-hmm. He said, you're just talking loud and you're saying nothing. Let me tell you, if we're going to have dignity, you ought to vote. Yes. Not only ought you vote, you ought to always realize that if there's going to be any hope, even though we vote, our voting won't save us. If we vote, we ought to vote. People died for the vote and the right to vote. We ought to vote, but our vote will not save us. Our vote will not help us. Many African Americans thought that President Obama was going to deliver us from all of our troubles. But let me just share with you. You can't put your confidence in any man other than Jesus, because he's the one that gave his life for the church. He is the hope of glory. He is the hope of our dignity. He is the one that dignifies us. Verse 28. Colossians chapter 1. Verse 28. Him we preach. Who is him? Jesus Christ. Who is him? Jesus Christ, our hope of glory. We ought to preach him. I never will forget, and I never will stop talking about it. preacher said to me, the reason why your church is not as big and as fabulous as my church and doesn't have as many people coming through the doors as my church has coming through it is because you're preaching that old gospel. He said to me, you're going to have to stop preaching that old gospel in order to get folk to come through the door. You got to start preaching current events. Talk about what's happening now. Talk about what's going on. Talk about some of the topics that young folk are going through. Yes, we ought to talk about those topics, but the fact is, when it's time to preach, we ought to preach Jesus. Verse 28 says, him we preach. Jesus we preach. We ought to preach Jesus, him crucified, him resurrected. We have to preach Jesus, because I can talk about all the current events that I want to. I can talk about the right to vote as long as I want to. But it's not the right to vote. It's not the voting itself. Neither is it the complaining. Neither is it the marches. All these things we must do. But what we must do above all things, the preachers, the teachers, have to preach and teach Jesus. For when we do not preach and teach Jesus, we are most miserable. God forgive the preacher who does not preach Jesus. I never will forget, a young man walks up to me who's pastoring the church. He walks up to me after Michael Jackson passed away. He said, I don't know what I'm going to do today. I don't know if I'm able to preach this Sunday. Why is that? Oh, Michael Jackson died this week. I said, excuse me? He said, I don't know if I'm going to be able to preach because Michael Jackson died this week. I said, well, brother, first of all, you didn't know Michael was going to die. Let me just tell you this. You're going to die. All of us going to get out of here, whether we leave here in the rapture or we're dead. We're going to have to leave here. We got to get out of here. So it was such a great surprise to you that Michael Jackson died? And then I went on to say, well, brother, if it was such a surprise to you, you telling me you're that devastated because Michael Jackson died that you can't preach Jesus? So I came to a conclusion. I had him to know. I said, brother, I tell you what you do. Call your pastor who licensed you the pastor. Call your pastor who licensed you to preach. Call your pastor who ordained you. Turn in both your license, your ordination license and your preaching license, because you are not worthy of carrying either one of them. The text declares, verse number 28, Colossians chapter 1 declares that we ought to preach Jesus, not Michael. We ought not get so disturbed until our mind is all in shambles because a superstar passes away. A movie star leaves us because an entertainer, it's over for him or her. The text declares, verse number 28, him we preach. It doesn't matter whether the folk flock in the place or not. Romans chapter 1 verse 16 says that I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation, unto the Jew and also to the Greek. It is the power of God unto salvation. To the Jew, to the Greek, to the Gentiles, to the African American, to the Anglos, to the Caucasians, whatever name you want, to the Asians. It is the power of God unto salvation. Amen. Let me tell you, preachers, preach Jesus. Amen. He says, him we preach. Goes on to say, warning every man. We ought to preach Jesus and warning every man. Reminding every person that Jesus is the great mystery that has been revealed, reminding every person that one of these days, that same Jesus we preach is coming back again. reminding every person that that same Jesus Christ that we preach is going to rise one day, stop in midair as he's sitting right now on the right hand of the Father. One of these days, he's going to catch a cloud the same way he left here on a cloud. He's going to catch a cloud, come back in here, stop in midair. The trump of God will sound, the voice of the archangel will take place, and when those two things happen, he will stop in midair, and those who died in Christ shall rise first, and those of us who are still walking around who believe the story of Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection will be caught up with them in midair. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah to the Lamb. We will be caught up with him in midair. We ought to warn every man, warn every child, warn every person that Jesus Christ is coming back again. There are some who believe then that, as some believe now, that he's not coming back again. Jesus is coming back again. And let them know, if you left here after he comes back, you're going through the great tribulation. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 9 that there will be a meteor, there will be a star that hits the ground, falls to the earth, and locusts will crawl out of it. And these will not be any little small locusts. These locusts will be like horses and will have a sting on them that will sting man for 5 whole months. Look at it, Revelation chapter 9. It will sting man for 5 whole months. And when it stings a man for 5 whole months, it's going to hurt so terribly until man going to want to die and cannot die. You better catch that trip out of here with Jesus. Because there will come a day where these locusts will sting man for 5 whole months. They will desire to die. And the Bible says that death will flee from them. What it says to us is men will jump off of tall buildings, hit the ground, splatter on the ground, and won't die. The Bible says that it will sting man, but it won't hurt the earth, won't hurt the vegetation. It will sting man, and death will be on the run. Death will flee from us. Men will try to commit suicide. And they will not be able to kill themselves because death will be on the run. You better catch this trip out of here. The rapture is coming. But we are to call men to faith by lifting up and preaching Jesus and warning them, giving them a warning. For every man, there ought to be a warning that one of these days, if you miss the trip, you will have to go through some tribulation. Some hardship. Death will be on the run. But let me tell you, you don't have to stay around here to Revelation chapter 9. You can be seen in Revelation chapter 4, where the writer, John, says, I saw heaven. You can get out of here and get to heaven. He goes on to say, in Colossians chapter 1, verse 28, he says, we preach Jesus. Him we preach Jesus, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom. We ought to be teaching. See, preaching is to declare, to show, to speak, and to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. We ought to declare, to show men, to speak, and to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. And when we warn them, we put in their minds. Warn means to caution them. Warn means to admonish them to do differently. Warn means to reprove them. But when we teach, we ought to train them. We ought to help them to learn. We ought to take men, women, boys, and girls and teach them. Titus says the older women ought to teach the young women how to be godly women, how to love their husbands, how to take care of their children, how to be keepers at home. We ought to teach people. Here it says, teaching every man in all wisdom. Word wisdom means understanding, The word wisdom refers to practical things. Have intelligence. The word wisdom is the ability to discern. In other words, back home, we would say word wisdom means to have mother wit. Stuff you don't learn in school, stuff you can't get in colleges and universities. Wisdom, how to think, how to rationalize, how to understand, how to do practical stuff, how to think practically. Problem with young people is that we don't think practically. You don't spend all your money today because rainy day is coming. You don't hang out with the wrong crowds because if you hang out with the wrong crowd, you're going to be associated with them. If you hang out with the wrong crowds, you're going to go down when they go down. Wisdom. We need children with wisdom. Let me tell you three ways to get wisdom. Number one, you get wisdom by asking it of God. The Bible says, if a man lacks wisdom, he ought to ask it of God. Every day of your life, you ought to ask God for wisdom. A spirit of discernment to do some things that are right before the Lord. The first way to get wisdom is the action of God. The second way to get wisdom is to read Proverbs. Every young person and some old people need to read the book of Proverbs every day to get some practical outline situations down in your spirit. The book of Proverbs have 35 books, 35 chapters. You can read a chapter a month, a chapter a day. For the whole month, then when the next month starts over, read the book of Proverbs every month, one chapter a day. And when your months don't have 31 days, you double up the last 2 days to get wisdom. So the first thing is you ask God for wisdom. The second thing is you study Proverbs. The Bible says that Proverbs teaches us wisdom. The third way to get wisdom, and these are just practical points, the third way to get wisdom is to sit with someone who has wisdom. We need an intergenerational connection. We need young people who are sitting with seniors and learning what got them to where they are. I understand there are some seniors that have made some bad decisions. I made a plenty of them myself. I'm too embarrassed to tell you about them, but you need to sit with some seniors that have done some good things in life and learn what they did. The same things that they did years ago is good for today. Amen. I remember sitting on Slim Street with my cousins. They were 78 and 80 years old. Two senior women and a senior man. He was a preacher. He was a pastor. And we call him preacher because he was a preacher. So he was a preacher of the family. On Slim Street, I was sitting on an oak tree with two senior women and one senior man, and just sit there and listen to what they had to say. I like to say that I gained wisdom and practical principles from them sitting there. Says we need to warn people, warn every man, teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Jesus Christ. We're responsible. We're responsible to present. This word present means to show. This word present means to provide. This word prevent means to stand and command. We're responsible for the people we meet. We're responsible for the people we talk to. So don't be jiving and shucking every time you talk to people. Give them wisdom, a spirit of wisdom that you can present them later on. I remember leaving and moving to Houston, and about 20 years later, I went and looked up Coach Jack Thompson. Coach Jack Thompson taught me how to deal with English well. My 10th grade teacher, it was about 20 years later, I went and looked him up. He was working at Lanier High School in Jackson, Mississippi. Hadn't seen him since graduation. I went and looked him up, sit down and talked to him and said, thank you, man. Thank you for teaching English well. Thank you for teaching a boy that stuttered, a boy that couldn't get words out, a boy that couldn't really read too good. Thank you for coaching English and not just teaching English. He was a baseball coach, so he coached English. He coached it. He made English interactive. And 20 years later, I looked him up just to say thank you. When I go home, I stop and holler at Mr. White and say, man, thank you for teaching me what Dartmouth College was all about. Thank you for teaching me what the Tea Party was. Thank you for teaching me what the Boston Massacre was all about. Because they gave us wisdom, they gave us knowledge, and they presented us. And now several of us are doing things that we've been taught to do and to do it well. That's how it is in this life of Christianity. As we see people from day to day, as we walk with people from day to day, we ought to be able to present them back to Jesus Christ different, holy. Somebody ought to say that you made a difference in their lives, and that's why they are sanctimonious right now. That's why they are saved right now. And finally, at the Gentry High School, room number 2, Miss Bonner's 6th period class, around 2:30 in the evening on a Tuesday, May 6th. Dorothy Steele turned around and looked at me and said, you don't have to keep living the way you're living. You can be changed right here, right now in this room. She said to me, birds don't have to fly around the room. Birds don't have to sing. The sky doesn't have to quake. The earth doesn't have to quake. The sky doesn't have to open. But what you must do is repentantly believe that Jesus is the Son of God. And out of obedience unto God, he gave his life as a ransom for you and me. Amen. Dorothy had my attention. I bowed my head in that room that day, not room number 2, across the hall from the cafeteria. I bowed my head and invited Jesus into my life. And now she's able to present me before the Lord Jesus Christ. As a saved being, we ought to be willing to present men before the Lord. Every man perfect in Christ. And this word perfect is not like the word perfect that you see in today's language. This word perfect means complete morally. Word perfect means mentally stable. This word perfect means a spiritual character that is mature in the Lord. So we ought to present people back to Christ. In maturity, because you have cultivated in them maturity. You have cultivated their lives, and you put something in their lives that you can present back to God and say, God, you told me to minister, and this is what I present to you. A man perfect. Verse number 29, and I'll leave you alone. Colossians chapter 1, verse 29. To this end, I also labor. Paul says these things that I just mentioned from verse 26 through 29. He says, to this end, because God has made it possible, because God has revealed the mystery. And verse 26 talks about the mystery. God has revealed the mystery that has been hidden from one generation to the other. Verse 27, he says, because God willed it so, because God willed it to make known these great mysteries, these great riches of glory through Jesus Christ our Lord. It's no longer a mystery because it's been revealed. He want to present this mystery even to those who have bad ideas. Even to those who are not saved, he wants to present. Even to the Gentiles, which is in Christ Jesus. He says, I'm here for you. And he says that we ought to make sure that men understand that Jesus is the hope of glory. Amen. We ought to anticipate it. And then he says to preachers, when you preach, preach him. We preach him. We preach Jesus. Him we preach is what he says. Then he says for those of us who are teachers, teach people to be discerning. Give people wisdom about what you say and what you do. He says so you can present them perfect. Present them before the Lord Jesus Christ, Jesus the Son of God. And Paul says in verse number 29, because of all this stuff, to this end also I labor. The word labor means I work hard. The word labor means I toil. To this end I toil. To this end I am wearied. Paul says, I'm weary in my work. He says, I have toiled. I've worked hard. until I've gotten tired. I've gotten worn out. Let me tell you, if you're going to be worn out about anything, you ought to be worn out about presenting Jesus. If you're going to be tired, you ought to be ministering to somebody. At the end of the day, and you look back over your life, can you say to this end, I've labored, striving according to his working, which works in me mightily. He says I'm striving. This word striving means I'm struggling. You know, it's a bad thing when you see somebody always talking about, man, I'm just having such a bad time. All of us struggling with something. But are you struggling for Jesus' sake? Are you struggling for Christ's sake? Are you struggling for the church's sake? Are you struggling for the saints' sake? All of us are struggling with something. All of us got something wrong. He says we are struggling. Paul says that I'm striving, I'm struggling. He says I'm contending. This word struggling, this word striving means that I'm contending with the adversary. Me, I'm fighting the devil as if I'm fighting for a prize. He says I'm striving, I'm struggling, I'm contending against the adversary for a prize. And I endeavor to accomplish something. I endeavor to minister. I endeavor to accomplish something. I endeavor to fight with fervor. To fight fervently. To fight on fire. Not to let the fire go out. We ought to be excited about fighting. Word according, this word according means that I'm fighting with intensity. Yes. Working, operating strong, with strong energy. And this word strong energy, mightily, meaning I'm doing wonderful things. I'm fighting with power. I'm fighting violently, working for the Lord. This word mightily comes from the same word we get the word dynamite, dunamis. It comes from the word dunamis, which means explosive, meaning that I have the ability. God has given us the ability to minister with power, to minister with might, to minister with fervor. We ought to be about God's business. When sports is not to be seen, we ought to be about God's business. When sports is available to us, we still ought to be about God's business. Because I know one thing. Quarterback number 4 got paid this week. He got paid well. But he did not call me to give me one dime. He didn't call me to make any donation to the church. Number 4 got paid well. And he deserved it. He's Deshaun Watson. He's one of the greatest, if not the greatest, quarterbacks yet to be. That is in existence today. But he didn't call me at all. But over 2,000 years ago, Jesus Christ paid the price. He paid it for me. And he paid it for you. Over 2,000 years ago, Jesus died. The great hope of glory. He died to give me a place in heaven. Over 2,000 years ago, he took a tree, went up a hill called Calvary, and gave his life for me. He died. He gave his life for me. He knows me by name. Deshaun Watson doesn't even know my name. Doesn't know where I live. Doesn't know where the church is located. I'm trying to have a service for all of them to come by one day. But the fact of the matter is, Jesus paid the price. Died on Calvary. So I can make it to heaven. He did the same thing for you. Jesus died for you. And because he died and rose again, you can be saved here tonight. All you have to do is give your life to Christ. And you can thrive. You can strive. You can struggle for him. And even in our struggles, Jesus is walking with us. We ought to strive for the Lord in such a way, it's like we are commanded to contend against the adversary. You need to be born again. You need to get to know Jesus. If you can believe the story that Jesus died for your sins, he was buried in a borrowed tomb, you can receive him tonight. if you believe that he rose from the dead. Would you just repeat after me and invite Jesus Christ into your life? Just repeat after me as I pray, and you repeat after me in prayer, believing the story that Jesus died for your sins and rose from the dead. I want you to just bow your head and say, Lord Jesus, I believe that you are the Son of God. I believe that you died for my sins. I believe that you rose from the dead. Now come into my life and make me a new person. Thank you for saving my soul. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank God. If you received Jesus as your Savior tonight, inbox me and let me know that you have received him so we can rejoice with you. And if you're in between church homes or don't have a church home, I recommend the New Beginning Church, where Jesus is the center of attraction and the main focus. If you want to join the New Beginning Church, inbox me and let me know that you want to join him. Even electronically, we will receive you into the family of faith. If you want to ask for prayer, do that. Inbox me and let me know that you need prayer. And some have done that. Let me know that you need prayer, and we'll be glad to pray with you and pray for you. And now it is time for us to give to the Lord through tithes, offering, and sacrificial gifts. It is offering time. It is time to give to the Lord. You can give to the Lord in three ways. You can give by way of Cash App. Our cash tag is NBC Souls, NBC Souls. $NBC Souls. Or you can give by Zelle. Our Zelle account can be reached at lifting.jesus@yahoo.com. 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 Or you can give by mail, by mailing your offering into New Beginning Church, P.O. Box 503, Missouri City, Texas. P.O. Box 503, Missouri City, Texas. You can give by P.O. Box 503, Missouri City, Texas, 77459. 77459. Thank you so much for joining us here tonight for our Bible study. You can join us every Wednesday night for our Bible study at 7:20 p.m. And you can join us on Sunday morning for our Sunday school class at 9 a.m. Our Sunday school is at 9 a.m. And you can join us on Sunday morning at 10:45 a.m. for our worship service. Again, thank you for joining us. Thank you for being a part of our service. Thank you for this time with us. And please, ma'am, please, sir, keep praying for our leaders of our nation and our world. Please go out to vote. Some is waiting for November 3rd to vote. October 13th is my day. If you want to join me, if you're in the state of Texas, you want to join me for early voting, you can do that. Whatever you do, go and vote your choice. Don't just protest, go vote. Pray for the New Beginning Church and pray for God continue to shine his light upon us. On Sunday, we'll be celebrating 16 years of uninterrupted service where I've been pastoring the New Beginning Church. I'm so happy. I'm so glad that God has given us an opportunity to come to the New Beginning Church and be a part of it, where lives are being changed, hope is being renewed, souls are being saved. Thank you so much for joining us. Thank you, Sister Davis, for providing our music. Thank you for being a part of this service. Let's go to God in prayer. Father God, we thank you now and we bless your name. God, we thank you for all that you do and all that you will do. We thank you for the hope of glory. We thank you that the mystery has been revealed. We thank you for Jesus the Christ. We anticipate his coming. We will preach Jesus. We will teach wisdom. And we will warn every man, woman, boys, and girl that the day of reckoning is coming. Lord, we know that men are doing all kinds of things, but we know that you're not asleep, and the day of reckoning is coming. Lord, we thank you now for blessing us to come this way. We thank you for blessing us to hear your word. We ask you to continue to walk with us. Lord, we ask you to bring this virus under control. We ask you, Father God, to shut it down. We ask you to kill it off. We ask you to open doors for scientists and technicians and medical staff to reveal a cure. And Lord, if it's in your will, you can shut it off, because we know you are the great doctor, the great physician. And Lord, we'll be careful to give you all the honor, all the glory, and all the praise. It's in Jesus' name we pray and we ask it all. Amen and thank God. We at the New Beginning Church, we are uniting the church, strengthening families, supporting schools, and empowering neighborhoods to impact the world as we are reaching souls by lifting Jesus. Jesus says, "And I, if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto me." John 12:32. God bless you and God keep you is our prayer. Thank you so much for joining us here at the New Beginning Church.